But let me start by welcoming you to this lecture in honor of David Dickson, and a particular welcome to members of David's family. Thank you for coming. And to our guest speaker, Chris Whitty, who will be speaking later. I'd like to thank also the staff of SciDevNet who have managed to call you and let you know this is coming, in particular to Mariama, who has kept us online and in coming. David, as you know, dedicated his life to science journalism and to improving and increasing access to science in languages that were accessible. Science is often something where we develop our own codes and words and acronyms and abbreviations and terms which aren't necessarily intelligible to the wider world. David felt passionately that science needed to be explained, it needed to be made more accessible. He believed passionately in the role that science and knowledge could play in improving policy making, informing decision making, reducing poverty, human misery, and environmental degradation. I first met David at the World Science Conference in Budapest in 1999, where he was voicing the idea of setting up a website that would be populated by well-published articles, up-to-date and objective pieces, and to provide an open source of information at a time when science was being published in science journals and in publications where payment was required and access inevitably restricted, and where most of them were published in English. At the time when he was talking to people in Budapest, this seemed to be a pretty far out idea. Interesting, a good idea, but would anyone put the money on the table? Would anyone provide the necessary support? However, at this world conference and at the meeting, there was concern that huge public investment in research was not necessarily producing the results and access to the results that benefited society and justified public investment. There was also concern about the role that intellectual property and copyright would play, well, were playing in restricting access to knowledge. So David's idea was a good idea at the right time. He came with a long and successful career in science journalism. He'd worked with the New Scientist, New Science, and Nature. He had a huge network of friends and colleagues around the world. And perhaps those of us who are on the administrative side and in the civil service somewhat underestimated David's persistence and determination to carry forward the idea that he had. He used his network, he used his powers of persuasion, he used his dogged determination, and his reputation which he had built and the network that he had constructed to bring to bear the idea that we create SciDevNet. So it was an idea that suited the moment. It was a modest idea that was worth trying. So in 2000, a project was initiated by the news staff of Nature, and I'm sorry that Philip Campbell, who was part of the first board, who is still at Nature, was unable to come. He just sent an email this morning to say he couldn't join us. And with support from the Wellcome Trust, and I think we have colleagues from the Wellcome Trust this evening, managed to get this idea running with a bit of extra funding from DFID. But SciDevNet itself was not set up until 2001, and David was appointed as its founding director, and its first board was led by Jeff Oldham, who I'm sure after in the intervals will tell you all about the fun of setting up the organization. And so the rest is history. Since SciDevNet was set up, it's received generous support, not only from DFID, but also IDRC in Canada, Swedish CEDA, AusAid, the Dutch government, and others. Its reputation has grown and its reach has expanded. The network spread first to Africa, then to Latin America, then to South Asia, and then to Middle East, and more recently to Southeast Asia and the Pacific. So it is now truly global in its reach. I joined the board in 2007, when the reputation and a lot of the work about building networks had already been established. But at that stage, funding was getting harder. Good ideas were no longer getting money. People were asking, does it make a difference? Did it work? How would we justify further public expenditure? Also, the environment within which SciDevNet was operating, ITCs, the communication technologies, had advanced hugely. Facebook, Twitter, various other things were growing. And our funders were interested not so much in the quality of our products and our outputs and our website, but were we having an impact? Were we reducing poverty? Were people reading us? Were we influencing debate? Were we influencing policy? Did we make a difference? At that stage, David was quite worried about editorial integrity and our reputation. He had built SciDevNet as he had envisaged it, a freely accessible website to anyone that was open source and well, where the articles were well edited, well presented, and thoroughly accessible. But he wasn't a tweeter and a twitterer, nor was he a bureaucrat. He believed often in the traditional tension between the publisher and the editor, and he loved editing. He enjoyed writing, he enjoyed editing, he enjoyed mentoring people, but quite honestly, he found the bureaucracy and the management of an organization, the constant need to raise funding, was quite tiring and quite taxing. For David, standing down as director was not easy. He'd created something, he wanted to see it work, but it was a very stressful time, but he realized it was time for change. At that stage, one member of staff, Tracy Irvin, who's with us this evening, stepped into the gap to keep things moving and to help us with that. And until we found Nick to join us, and Nick Perkins will be known to many of you, and I'm sure you'll have a chance to meet him later. In semi-retirement, David seemed to be more relaxed, seemed to be more at peace, and he was able to continue his writing and mentoring, something that he enjoyed greatly, mentoring young scientists. But he was always modest about his writing and his constant care to get the facts right. I can remember him saying, "Are you sure? Let me just check this," etc. But he was a prolific and authoritative writer. And even in the last year that he was with us, he wrote on a huge range of subjects, bringing science to the people, what really holds back Islamic science, the gap between science and policy, local needs in science journalism, modernizing science social code, keeping open access science journalism in Africa. David had a dream. He realized it, something that few of us will ever do. SciDevNet is his legacy and our responsibility. But the job of communicating science, of making it more accessible, making it more available, of bringing young journalists in and helping with the communications is never done and will continue. Therefore, I think it's extraordinarily fitting that Chris Whitty has kindly agreed to give this memorial lecture. Chris is the Chief Scientific Advisor at DFID, as well as being Director of Research and Evidence in DFID. He is Professor of Public Health, Public and International Health at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. He's a consultant physician, a visiting professor in public health at the Gresham College. And although he trained in medicine and did postgraduate work in epidemiology, economics and law, he has worked extensively in the field in Africa and Asia and been involved in the development of science policy in the UK. As a particularly hard nut of making sure that DFID is evidence driven and takes the best use of what it does, and to make sure that the huge investment that DFID makes is also justified and produces desired results. So Chris, I believe you will speak to us for about 30, 35 minutes. You've kindly agreed, if you didn't know it, to answer any questions. And then Nick will have an announcement at the end of that. So Chris, over to you.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much. I mean, I can vividly remember the first time that I met David. He bounded up to me at the Royal Society where I was about to give a talk. And his opening gambit was, of course, what you say will be very dull because you're a civil servant. And they've only invited you because of your title. However, I'd like to ask you for some money. I'm shortening a longer conversation, but that was the gist of it. So that was quite possibly the most impressive opening gambit for people who suggested they wanted a grant from DFID I've yet had. Actually, it was very much an example of his honesty. And he was a phenomenally honest writer, a very, very good journalist of science. And one of the pleasures of preparing for this lecture has been rereading many of his articles. And many of them are really outstanding. For example, the one that Andrew just mentioned on why is there not enough science in the Islamic world is something which I think bears a lot of rereading in the current environment. Very, very, a very perceptive piece. Now, I'm going to view this because most people in the audience, they're not all, are from science journalism or communication. So I'm going to take the opposite end. I'm going to start off from what I am, which is someone in the sort of within the policy environment, but with a scientific background. And I'm going to address the exam question I was set by Andrew and Nick, which was around why it is we do not get better science into policy. Now, the starting point on this has to be, and I think I'm starting in this because I think this is often underestimated, it is really important that we do take politics seriously. We render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's. And many people fail to get science into policy because they treat politicians as if they had a second-class calling, that the scientists are the clever people and the politicians somehow just there to enact their will. This is clearly not going to work. There is a very serious role for politics. Politics drives, and science is secondary to that. And I think we always have to take very, very clear cognizance of that. The second thing is, and again, something which a lot of scientists forget, is that Caesar, in all of her or his forms, is usually trained in economics and is surrounded by economists. There is nobody between me in the hierarchy in the civil service and the Queen who is not actually trained in economics, whether I go up the political or the civil service line. Economics is the language of politics, and therefore of policy. So if you make an argument and cannot actually couch it in economic terms, you should realize you're going significantly to reduce the chance you're going to get into policy. That would be my first sort of simple point about this. I'm now going to talk much more about the science end. And the main thing that I'm going to come back to repeatedly is the idea of the technical to political continuum. Now, I'm not very good at doing PowerPoint slides, so this is for those who do sailing, the man overboard flag, but with words put on top of it, because I can just about manage that technically. And the point I wanted to make with this, and I'm hoping that I can get this thing to work, not I'm going to do it the old-fashioned way, is that there are decisions at both ends of the spectrum. There are decisions that are purely political. So the decision for a politician to, in my department, for example, and the same would be true in Nigeria or Tanzania or Uganda, whether they wanted to put some money, for example, through the World Bank or through an NGO, is a purely political decision. The decision whether they want to look after maternal health in Nigeria or girls' education in Afghanistan or build roads in Tanzania is a political decision. Ultimately, it is not a technical decision. There may be a little bit of technical information in it. It is purely political. At the other end, the actual operational end, it is a purely technical decision. How you build a bridge is not something I would expect a politician to do. In fact, I'd be very cautious about driving over a bridge designed by most politicians I know. Equally, when politicians, for example, start trying to get engaged, as some Nigerian politicians are at the moment, in deciding what kind of bed net or what kind of treatment you have for malaria, that leads to disaster. So at the two ends, you've got the purely political and the purely technical scientific questions in development. But between those two, there is a huge continuum where you need a little bit of science and a lot of politics, or sometimes a lot of science and a bit of politics. And understanding where you are on that spectrum is a lot of the key to understanding how you're going to get something through to policy. Now, for convenience, I'm going to look at the huge, rich tapestry of science, and I'm going to break it into three different types. This is just so I can actually convey a few points on this. The first is new technologies and new products. The second is the science, generally observational science, to understand the operating environment we're in so that we can make better decisions. And the third is the science of testing out better forms of delivery. Now, each of these forms of science has a different sort of a challenge if you want to try and convey it, which all of you are trying to do, and get it into policy, which I'm trying to do. Let's start with technology. Now, I'm going to give just two slides. These are both slides that I have shown ministers, and they will grasp immediately on looking at them. They are very straightforward. Explaining technology to politicians and policymakers is incredibly straightforward. You simply say, this thing has got more vitamin A, this orange sweet, flesh sweet potato on the top, for example, or this right on the bottom. Vitamin A is something which reduces the chance of dying if you've got measles. It's a big problem. Therefore, this is a good thing. I mean, I'm obviously simplifying slightly. Very straightforward to convey new technologies. Moving on to a slightly more difficult concept, sticking to agriculture, trying to talk through how different varieties of crops have different degrees of yield or different degrees of heat or drought tolerance. Again, you're talking relatively straightforward. It's a product, you can feel it, you can look at it, you can hold it in your hand, and you can explain in very simple linear terms how this is going to work. So conveying technology in science is not at all difficult. In fact, the problem with technology, the technological kind of science in policy, is quite the reverse. That there's much of a, it's very easy for people to believe they've got a technology and that has solved the problem. Just taking a couple of examples from my own field, for example, this is a Times headline from almost a decade ago now, that malaria vaccine has just been produced that is going to save millions of children. This is a nice vaccine. It works about as well as a bed net, costs a lot more. The idea that this is going to solve malaria is clearly laughable if you think it through, but if it's sold in the right way, this can sound an incredibly easy way of dealing things. This is a genetically modified mosquito. American labs are full of genetically modified mosquitoes that cannot catch malaria. Every summer, I'm prepared to bet there will be a colour supplement article about genetically modified mosquitoes between now and August whilst the politicians are on holiday, because they have fantastic photos, the technology sounds great, and it's an extremely linear thing to explain. So the problem with technology is the reverse of the problem in much of the rest of science, is trying to persuade people this is not the solution, whilst it may have some small part to play. So the challenges for communicating new technology for policy, in my view, are four, really. The first is being realistic about the difficulties of uptake of technologies. Having a technology and having a technology used are two totally different problems. Secondly, not allowing them to be oversold, the point I've just made. The third, and I really would stress this, if you do think a technology is the right answer, do a proper economic analysis. Because ultimately, this has got to be compared to other things. The idea in economic terms of the opportunity cost of this intervention. If you do not do an economic analysis, and I'm constantly being given technological answers by colleagues from the scientific community who have not worked out the fact that their solution will work, but it'll cost 10 times as much as a solution currently being applied, and this does not seem a terribly good idea. The science is great, but the economics don't stack up. And generally, most genuine bits of technology that will work are firmly at the technical end of the spectrum. They should not really be getting into the politics at all, although they're very attractive. Moving on to observational data, I'm going to give a few examples of observational data with increasing difficulty to explain it. These are where you're saying to policymakers, politicians, civil servants, whether it's in Africa, Asia, or the UK, this is something you need to understand before you make your political decision. It won't tell you what to do, and that's a really important point, but it'll tell you the operating limits around what you can do. So the first one I'm going to give an example is around malaria transmission in Nigeria. Why is it that you want to do seasonal malaria treatment in northern Nigeria, but that will not work in southern Nigeria? And that's very straightforward. You simply can explain that in the north, there's only 3 months of the year there's malaria in Nigeria, and in the south, it's year-round. Very straightforward. That's simple observational data. Moving up to a slightly more difficult thing to convey, because everyone can read maps pretty well, even in these days of TomTom, demographics. Demographics will drive a large amount of what is going to happen in the world. So the thing I've chosen is something from the demographic profile of Iran in this year and where we project it will be in 20 years' time. And for this, you need to be able to explain to someone how a demographic pyramid works. Most of you can probably work this out, but it's just in age bands, men and women on either side of the pyramid, and then the age bands you got on the way and the total numbers in terms of millions in the case of Iran. And the point you can make with this to a politician, it's an important point, I've made this point to my colleagues in the Ministry of Defense, for example, is that at this moment, the biggest group of people in Iran are people between the ages of 20 and 30, and a large number of them are men. Wait 20 years, and because of the particular population pyramid of Iran, these people are going to age to be parents or even grandparents, and the probability is Iran will feel a very different community, very possibly view conflict in a very different way to the Iran we have today. That doesn't tell you what to do as policy, but it is an important point you need to take on board if we want to try and work out what our stance should be to Iran looking over the next decade. Now, one of the problems with science is very often in our efforts as scientists to simplify for policymakers who are not scientists, we oversimplify. So let's take an example. I would guess that most policymakers genuinely have taken on board the fact that global warming, climate change, will lead to more storms. They are aware of the fact that most humanitarian disasters occur in very poor places, and therefore they assume that more storms will occur in Africa, and this will be a very bad thing. The last point of those is incorrect. So there will be an increase in storms with global warming. That's a certainty. But global warming over the next 20 years is not going to shift where storms occur. This is a map of every major storm tracked over a century. None of them virtually hit Africa. Africa is not going to have a problem as a result of storms from global warming because there are no storms in Africa. So you need, if you're going to simplify, don't oversimplify. It's an important fact that global warming leads to more storms, but be aware of the fact that many parts of the poor world in Africa and Asia will not actually be affected by this at all. So this oversimplification can be a problem. And in reality, just thinking about climate change, it is actually an incredibly complicated thing to try and convey. And we need to work out very clearly what it is we're trying to do. This is a nice paper from Hawkins and Sutton. And their point was, there's enormous uncertainty about climate actually viewed over a 100-year time frame. The initial things is around internal variability, things like the El Nino Southern Oscillation, which, for example, is going to probably happen this year, later on in the year, if the Met Office is right, which I'm sure it is on this one. Then as you go on, the model uncertainty, the fact our climate models are a bit unclear, is going to dominate. There's a lot of uncertainty around that. But the further out in time you go, the scenario uncertainty, what kind of environment, are we in a 2-degree world or a 4-degree world, dominates. But I would add another one on top of that again, which is the Africa of now is going to be a completely different Africa from the Africa of 30 years. And a lot of people who look at climate change seem to assume that Africa will be exactly the same degree of poverty in 30 years as it is now. Probably the GNI of most African countries we work in will be 2 times what they are now. So thinking ahead and not oversimplifying the message is important. And it is very tempting when someone hasn't fully grasped your point to try and simplify and simplify until it gets to the point it is virtually meaningless. Synthesis, which I'm going to come back to, putting it in context with appropriate caveats, that's really important because there is a danger otherwise it gets well out of context. And then making a political judgment yourself about how hard you should push. Should you say to a policymaker, actually, I think this is probably the most important thing you need to make to have in your decision making, or should you say, here's a useful fact along with 700 other facts and your own political judgment. And it is, to some extent, our job to make the political judgment as to where that is, because it's not fair, in a sense, to ask a non-specialist to try and make that judgment for us. And that's the most difficult, I would say, in dealing with the observational sciences, if I'm being honest. But the most difficult to communicate science, in my experience, is the testing out ways of delivering things better. And yet, this is the area with, in my experience, the greatest potential to get better policy for development, whether you're an African cabinet secretary, a UK politician, or indeed someone working in the field. And it will become more important for reasons I'm about to come on to. And my view is this kind of science, where we actually say, how, you know, we know that we could prevent every malaria death in Africa with drugs that cost under £1. We know that, but it's not happening. Why is it? What's the delivery problem we've got? We know that there is a yield gap across Africa where all smallholders in Africa, on average, could increase their yield by 40% with current technologies that would actually maintain their incomes over long periods. It's going to vary, obviously, by crop and by geography. Why have we failed here? These questions around delivery are probably the ones where we can have the fastest gains in development, and yet we fail. So why do we fail? Why is it going to become more important? Well, I'll just make four predictions, two of which I think are completely certain, two of which I think a bit more contested. The first one is almost every country that we work in development is going to become richer. So certainly I'm confident that most African countries will double their GNI if they carry on at current growth rates in the next decade. Many of them will then double it again. Because it's based on extractives, it's not a perfect form of development, but the fact is they will get richer. What happens as things get richer, people get richer, is that the cost of goods increasingly is irrelevant. A lot of what we do in development is based on cost of goods. Things like the Global Fund for HIV, TB and malaria, for example, is based on the idea the drugs are too expensive. But actually, as people get richer, that ceases to be the problem, and increasingly the dominant thing is the cost of time. So how long someone sits in a waiting room will be far more important to them than how much the drug actually costs. So this shift, I think, is going to increase the need for this kind of science. Urbanization, I think, for a variety of reasons, is also going to do this. There's going to be an increased demand for skilled professionals, including scientists, over the next two or three decades, which will be massively faster than the increase in supply that's coming out of schools and universities in the developing world. And what that means is that poor people are probably, in my view, in 10 or 15 years, going to have less access to science and technical skills than they have at the moment. Because the group of people who can afford to pay is significantly expanding at a faster rate than the group of people who are there to supply. It's basic economics. And what you find in places like China and elsewhere is if you get a massive increase in the demand for technical skills from people who can afford to pay, the poor lose out. The private sector moves in and you end up paying more for a less good product, whether it's doctors, teachers, engineers, whatever. So this is a third major driver. And also, as poverty decreases, it will fragment. Most of what we do in development at the moment is based on the idea we just do mass things, mass bed net distribution, mass teaching to people about how best to use fertilizer and so on. The smaller and smaller the groups of poor people you get, the less cost-effective that will be. And that's going to make the delivery challenges in 10 years considerably greater than they are now. So all of these drive to these problems of delivery becoming probably the most important ones in policy. Now, this is a slide. The reason I've chosen this slide is it's the first slide of the talk, which David reliably predicted was going to be dull and pointless. But it made a point for that talk, and it also makes a point for this. And it's going back to Francis Bacon. He really is the father of the kind of practical science that David strongly believed in, and certainly I think most people in this room do. And I want to highlight, in particular, two of the things that he highlighted, one from the Idols of the Tribe, our tendency to rush to conclusions instead of accumulating evidence, which anybody who's worked in government will, I think, recognize. And he worked in government, so I think he knew what he was talking about. Government doesn't change much. And then the Idols of the Cave, which is a problem for the scientific disciplines, the fact we are all wedded to the discipline we come from. He made some other points, which including an enthusiasm for grand schemes, which people who go and look at some of the grand buildings that are being built north of the Eastern Road would, I'm sure, appreciate. Now, in terms of the first of these, I think the thing to understand is that policy, these kind of delivery questions, are more difficult because they are made up of multiple steps. There isn't a single bit of science you can do. So just taking a very simple, this is incredibly simple, delivery problem in, let's say, health, you might have a trial with a drug or a vaccine that's 90% effective. Maybe stockouts lead to only about 93%. That's not much of a reduction of people having it, and that's optimistic. The skill providers, the providers get the diagnosis wrong, they give it to the wrong people, it goes in a number of different areas. Then people who are given the drug don't know how to use it, they sell it on, they lose it, whatever it may be. And then the effect in practice drops away. And you could do this for virtually anything you talk about. What this means is most system problems are made up of multiple scientific questions, each one of which has got to be solved if you want to get there. So that's the problem about actually wanting to rush in. We always want to find a solution to, let's say, this and say we've cracked it, ignoring the fact there are multiple problems around it. And then there are supply side problems, the idols of the cave that that Bacon talked about. And these are ones really on the scientific side. Almost every serious step in this kind of delivery science requires multiple sciences from multiple disciplines. We're not good at that, I would say. As a scientist, I would say we are very bad at it. Few institutions, actually, even in the UK, even places like Oxford or Imperial, can alone perform genuine multidisciplinary research. And even the ones that can seldom do. Synthesis across disciplines is extremely difficult, which all of you will be aware of, I think, that someone who can do a really good synthesis for you of the biological science end may be pretty rubbish when they come to analyzing the social science end, and vice versa. Some academics are, I regret to say, actively dismissive of things they don't do, and generally, I would say, don't understand. So, you know, battles between qualitative and quantitative scientists would be funny if it wasn't for the fact they have a very negative impact on this. And in reality, we have to accept that the practical scientists are very low in the scientific hierarchy, as is synthesis. And you know, you won't get to see many people who are elected FRS, using that as a kind of a marker, who have done it purely on practical sciences. That's not a criticism of anybody, it's just an observation of fact. And of course, this is a problem because the typically moderate, difficult policy problem would, in my view, quite reasonably require anthropological, qualitative and quantitative data to get formative research to define the problem properly. Then an understanding of observational data from multiple disciplines, which might be the physical sciences, the biological sciences and the social sciences. Then they'll need experimental designs, including trials to test them. They'll need a qualitative explanation of why things have worked and why they haven't. And finally, you'll need an economic analysis. And then you'll need excellent synthesis that brings together all these different disciplines. That, in my view, is a pretty typical policy problem. And doing that is not straightforward. And communicating the science for that clearly also is not straightforward. So these are on the supply side. Moving over to the demand side, there are some problems I think we all have to work with as a given. The first is that, with a few exceptions, my experience is that in most policymakers' minds, more so arguably in Europe than in Africa and Asia, actually, science and research trigger some very unhelpful stereotypes for many policymakers. They don't mean to, but buried deep inside them, the model they have is either of a brilliant professor who doesn't understand the world, someone who's going to blind them with complicated mathematical equations they don't understand and think probably are irrelevant, some kind of bearded, pipe-smoking, tweedy lefty from the University of Sussex who's going to do something through a Marxist lens. You know, these are the kind of archetypes that people, when they hear the word, are actually going to start with. There is limited absorptive capacity, few scientifically trained people in government. That's just a reality. That's true whether it's the political side or the policy side, even the technical side. The UK is, I have to say, a lot better than most of our European continents. We do at least, for example, have chief scientific advisors and staff around them in virtually all the government departments. Even some of our Northern European colleagues look at that with some envy. But it is possible, I think, to exaggerate how much of an advantage we've got over some of the developing countries. If you go to China or to India and you talk to the Minister of Roads, they will be an engineer, usually. If you go to the Ministry of Agriculture, they will have been someone from the agricultural side. If you go to the Ministry of Health, they will often have been an academic doctor. So I think, although there's often thin skills in African and Asian countries, very often senior people are extremely highly trained and very often pick you up on the technical sides. And the NGO sector, which used, I think, to be quite hostile to research, in fact, that was my experience, is no longer. And many of the best of the NGOs are now really taking science very seriously indeed. And that's quite a sea change and a very welcome one. So the major challenges for dealing with the science delivery, I think, are getting policymakers to accept that many things don't work and some do active harm. I think the starting point of most people in development is everything works a bit, particularly if they were the person who designed it. Trying to get multidisciplinary research genuinely to work, and then, importantly, trying to get multidisciplinary synthesis to work. Understanding the context, something that works in one place doesn't work in another, and the fact that you need to understand the political cycle. Proving just before an election that the idea which a particular politician, on advice, has chosen to do probably didn't work and was a waste of money is not a very sensible thing to do. You just need to take a little bit of common sense to the fact that that there is a political cycle almost everywhere we work. So you need to get that right. So those, I think, are the problems. And I've laid out a whole series of problems because I think it's important all of us appreciate them. A few solutions, and this is a much shorter section, and then really leaving it up to other people for their views. The first thing to say is if you want to get more science in government, do more policy-relevant science. That might strike most people as obvious. Actually, it's not. Most of the people that I've seen who are most scathing, whether it's in Parliament or the press, or in the academic press, about the fact that science is not properly represented in government and why isn't there more science in government, have never done any policy-related research at all. It's quite striking. And so, you know, we do need, if we're serious about this, the scientific community need to get serious about providing the scientific evidence. How on earth are we expecting policymakers to use the science that doesn't even exist? So that's the first thing. The second is there's a great tendency to start with an excellent science and then try and find a policy problem that might fit it. And that might be to do with people who are trying to sell science from satellites, or it might be a nanotechnologist, or it might be someone like me, an epidemiologist. We start off with a skill, and we look around for the problem that might fit it, rather than starting with a problem and then working backwards to what the science should be. There's a wide variation in the amount of policy-relevant science by area. So, for example, health has always had, when I say always, for 30 or 40 years, very strong policy-relevant science. Until very recently, education did not. Why? No very good reason. And what's been very encouraging to me is even in the time that I've been in DFID, which is only about 5 years, education research, mainly in the social sciences, has really taken off. And I think is now probably one of the fastest growing areas of serious research activity. Fantastic. But there are other areas like governance where that simply isn't true. So, I mean, starting from a low base, but there is a lot of variation. And what's interesting to me is from Whitehall is the areas where DFID is weak, development is weak, is areas where Whitehall is weak. So education has got better both in DFID research and also in Whitehall research. Areas around governance are often weak in development and also up the road in some of the ministries in Whitehall. So it's a disciplinary issue, really. There's also frequent mispointing of the Haldane principle, which we easily can deal with, which ignores the fact that there's a serious market failure in policy-related research. People say you should just fund the best research and the magic will happen and science will somehow be useful. Very often that's true. In investigation-driven research answers very many problems, but there are very many problems which it does not. And neither does the current model of government funding and the private sector. And we should accept that and accept that government's part of government's job is to spot market failures and then try and iron them out. In policy terms, most world-class scientists are, in my experience, excellent tacticians, but they don't necessarily think strategically. They don't think about all the other bits of information not relevant to their field, which actually need to feed in. And I would just leave as an issue that we all need to deal with the extraordinary, furious reaction of many in the scientific community, for example, to the fact that a minority of money was given for the fact science was useful. Very interesting. And many of the same people who are most furious about this were the ones who are most vociferous about complaining there wasn't enough science in government. Well, in my view, you can have one, you can have the other, but you can't sort of have both. So I think this is something which we need to do. We need to put our own house in order on these ones. I think the easiest one to do this is on synthesis. Synthesis is the Cinderella of these sciences. The practical problem for people like me is policy is very fast. If you don't already have a synthesis, you have three choices. You ignore the evidence completely, or make it up, You work out what you want to do, then do a Google search, find the research that most closely approximates to your own policy, and then put a footnote in. That's not research, obviously, but that's not good. You phone a friend. You say, you know, I've heard that Andrew Bennett's a clever old person. He knew a lot about, agriculture, so I'm going to ask him about girls' education in Afghanistan, and if he's wise enough not to answer the question, very sensible. But, you know, so there is quite a bit of that. So, you know, favourite gurus are phoned, and some of them are liable to say things well out of their experience range. Or you do proper synthesis in advance. And very clearly, of those, the only one that makes any sense is doing proper synthesis. But synthesis is not taken seriously enough in the sciences. Systematic reviews is probably the only bit which is actually taken seriously. For example, it's the only kind of synthesis you can return in the ref, which is a model, which is in a sense a signal as to what the scientific establishment takes seriously. And even they are relatively low down in the hierarchy. But they're one tool to try and force people to be systematic about the way they actually bring science together, but obviously only one. So getting synthesis right, I think, is something which we collectively need to do. Moving fine, in my final few slides onto the stuff that is most directly relevant to CIDA, but I wanted to, do the stuff that's a bit further away from what most of you do in your day job. Improving the receptivity in government for science. And I think here I would say there are three solutions, all of which are incomplete. The first, which is most obviously talked about, is getting more scientists into government. Easier said than done, but I think there is a strong argument for that. And I think that the areas where there are more scientists, more science is taken seriously. That's just it's not a mathematical, you know, direct correlation, but there is some degree of correlation with it. The second, I think much more usefully, is to get technically minded people, but who don't have scientific backgrounds, much more comfortable about themselves reading science in a digestible form. And this is something where science journalists and organizations like SciDev can make a huge difference, because they can produce science, you know, an economist article can very often produce science beautifully written in a very short way that grabs the attention in a way that a sensible permanent secretary, a sensible minister, can easily read on the train and say, yeah, that's quite interesting, that's worth doing. So improving the capacity to understand technical evidence, which is a little bit of extra training, is definitely something we should do. And then improving the scientific discourse in public life. And here I'm reverting back to my background as an epidemiologist. There's something called the Rose hypothesis, which is around what you do about blood pressure. And Jeffrey Rose, a very famous epidemiologist, argued it may work, you know, the way we normally do it is we take a group of people and we say, you're hypertensive, the extreme end, the very, very high blood pressure, we'll give you some pills and ignore the rest. And actually what you need to do is you need to actually shift the whole blood pressure of the entire population slightly to the left by just a couple of small things like giving people less salt. And the second of those is less dramatic, but actually affects many more people. If we can make science just something which is slightly better understood across all of the population, my view is that is more effective than taking a few good scientists and parachuting them into policy. And that, again, is something which all of you are engaged in the whole time. Science communication is at the interface between the supply side, the scientists, and the demand side. It's really the way in which people start to actually make their policy decisions. And the model that's often promoted, which I think is a rubbish one, is to incentivize scientists to talk directly to policymakers, to say that their research is really important. And I'm afraid we all do this a bit. Funders do it, REF does it, lots of other things provide incentives to this. The big danger with this is this gives an incomplete picture, and all scientists, including myself, think their own research is more important and more important for policy than it actually is. So unfortunately, this often does more harm than good. My own view is that the simplest model you can use for this is there need to be three steps: the primary research, then a technical synthesis step, which brings together all the relevant evidence from various stages. And SciDev, I think, is one of the many ways in which this can be done, but it often needs to be done at several different levels, and then communicating that in a way which is easily digestible to policymakers. But in reality, for the great majority of complex questions, in fact, you're going to need primary research, then a synthesis within a discipline, then a synthesis across disciplines, and then a variety of just going up through various stages to make the messages both comprehensible but also remain accurate. And that is very much what I think SciDev and many others do so well, is help with that process happening properly. Science journalism, moving to the extreme end of this, really, the very top bit of that journey, from a policymaker's point of view, science journalists fall into three categories. There are people who are extremely good at doing fantastic science, incredibly neutrally laid out, that's completely irrelevant to policy. So many of the technical journals. Then there are quite a large number of scientific journalists. I can think of several in the high parts of medical journalism, for example, without thinking too hard, who got a very strong policy prior themselves. And your big worry with them is they publish policy-relevant research, but are they actually giving you a biased view of the picture? Because they start off with a personal bias on this. And then the perfect person, the fantastic scientist who understands the science, can communicate perfectly and is totally neutral in the way they view things. This nirvana-like creature does exist, and I think David was actually pretty close to it, David Dickson, but I think that it is something which is obviously more talked about than real sometimes. Because in reality, science journalism is a more complex ecosystem. There are multiple journalists who have multiple motivations, multiple levels of technical skill going to multiple different audiences. And I learn more from scientific journalists than I do from original scientists in much of what I do. The best scientific journalists, and we have several of them in the room, are fantastic. There is the odd Murray eel, the odd clownfish amongst them. Some of them are more flamboyant than others. But in general, it is one of the ways in which, in my view, one of the best ways in which you can actually get proper science to be understood by policymakers. And the best ones get it right, they get it neutral, and it's much more important to have someone who gets it right almost all the time and is neutral than someone who gets it wrong and is on your side. And I think the quicker many policymakers realize that, the better they like to do stuff. Finally, it's a way to the public, and sensible politicians listen at least as much to the public as they do to policymakers. So getting the you don't just go for the permanent secretary, you also want to talk to the school children and to the just general people chatting in the pub. So David Dickson did a remarkable job, in my view, and towards the end of the talk I've just given. He was really thinking about how we best get science to the policymakers so they can make the best decisions, whichever form of science it is. SciDev, I think, is a really remarkable organization compared to where it started, and I think a lot of that is a tribute to the extraordinary energy and vision that David had, and I'm very proud to therefore have been able to do this memorial lecture for him. Thank you very much.